the old covenant and inaugurated the new covenant. In your love you betrothed the church of all nations, and by your grace you built your foundation on Peter and the 12 apostles. Now make us worthy on this feast of the consecration and renewal of the church to raise a hymn of praise and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit forever.
Thank you.
fragrance of this incense as a pledge of our gratitude. May the bishops, priests, and deacons who serve at your altars guide the church in your spirit. We glorify and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Priest, of the good things that have come to be, passing through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made by hands, that is, not belonging to this creation. He entered once for all into the sanctuary, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption.
Praise be to God always.
Alleluia, alleluia.
You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against her.
Announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord.
Peace be with you. From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew, to proclaim life to the world, let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
The Apostle Matthew wrote, "When Jesus went into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, 'Who do people say that the Son of Man is?' And they replied, 'Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets.' And he said to them, 'But who do you say that I am?' Simon Peter said in reply, 'You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God.' Jesus said to him in reply, 'Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Yonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my heavenly Father. And so I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Sheol shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.' Then he strictly ordered his disciples to tell no one that he was the Messiah. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus.
Charged his disciples to tell no one that he was the Messiah. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. In the Gospel, our Lord only on three, maybe four occasions ever called himself the Christ, the Messiah. The reason for it is because in the centuries preceding his coming, the notion of Messiah took on a great political aspect, and even military. If you read the Psalms, you'll see it. Talking about the conquering of God, the hero, from the sea to the ocean and the lands. And so what happened is that the individuals and the interpretation
carnally interpreted the prophecies and the Psalms as not as a vindication and conquering of grace and redemption, but of a literal, political, military conquest. And so our Lord never called himself the Christ. And on this instance, when he's with his disciples, and they call him the Christ, which he obviously is, and he accepts, he tells them at the end, you're to tell no one about this. The other occasion that he does it is with the Samaritan woman at the well, because the Samaritans only used the first five books of the Old Testament, the books of Moses. And so all the prophecies, the Psalms, the later writings, they didn't use. So all of that politicization and militarism, they didn't interpret as part of the Messiah. For them, the Messiah was to be a teacher who was to lead them into all truth. And so with the woman in Samaria at the well, he told her that he was the Christ. And the third instance was, of course, during our Lord's trials, Passion, in which they, under oath, asked him, required him under oath to answer the question whether he was the Messiah or not. And of course he answered. This instance in the Gospel of St. Matthew, there's a lot to say about it, but we can't go into all the details. But I want you to just notice the context today, in this chapter 16. The first part begins with a discussion with the scribes and the Pharisees. And then our Lord making an application of the teachings of the Pharisees and the scribes to the apostles to clarify for them. And then we have today's gospel. And then after this, our Lord makes his prophecy, one of his several prophecies, of the upcoming betrayal and death and crucifixion and resurrection from the dead. Now, this gospel is chosen, of course, because this is the consecration of the church. Next week is the renewal of the church. These two Sundays begin our entire liturgical year, so of newness. So when the sermon is finished, we will use the holy water and we will go around the church and renew the blessing of the building, the blessing of the church space, for this renewal that begins every 12 months. Historically, this feast of the consecration of the church was literally the commemoration of the consecration of the Church of the Resurrection in Jerusalem, which was consecrated in the year 335. In 335, Constantine had the building put up. It was consecrated on September 13th, in 335, on the same date that had been used 250 years before to consecrate the Temple of Jupiter, that was on the place of the Dome of the Rock, that we now know as the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. And so Constantine purposely chose to have this church, this temple of Christ, be built of the resurrection to supplant the pagan temple, which had been put there 250 years before in the same city, not the same spot, in order to obliterate the Old Testament temple. And so all the churches of the East commemorated this event. But shortly after that, it took on a greater significance of not just simply a historical consecration, but of the renewal of the church, of us, as members of the body of Christ. So we have then chosen as the gospel today, we are given to read this profession of Simon Peter, or Simon Simana Kepha, in Aramaic. Simon Kepha, Simon Ra. And we have to remember that this name, Kepha, was given by our Lord to Simon when he first met him. And as throughout the Old Testament, we have Abraham being changed to Abraham, Sarai to Sarah, Jacob to Israel. The changing of names in the Old Testament always signify a changing of the position of what God is asking them to accomplish. So when Simon is dragged along by his zealous and pious younger brother Andrew, saying, we found the Messiah, he's not convinced. And then when he meets our Lord says, you are Simon, and we will call you from now on Boulder. We'll call you Rock, which we have no evidence whatsoever of it ever being used as a name anywhere, not in the Greek word, Petros, Peter that we know, This is something created because of our Lord. Now, Simon doesn't understand at the time that this is indicating something changing in his life. He just thinks this is just another unusual thing that my brother's dragging me through. But it's here where Simon answers the question. And it's important to understand we are told by St. Matthew where this takes place. It's in a city called Caesarea, but it's Caesarea of Philip, because there's a Caesarea on the coast. It's a harbor. And this city, when our Lord is there, is brand new. It's been rebuilt, made there in honor of Caesar, and Philip is one of the Herodian kings of the area, dedicated it to distinguish it from the port on the, it was called Caesarea of Philip. But it's built on a large cliff that oversees, it's a huge rock, it's a huge cliff that oversees basically the area which is the beginning of the Jordan River. So it's important to understand there's a city built which is quite visible above here. It is new, it is beautiful, it is rich. And our Lord at this point, in the midst of this scene, says, all right, we've been doing this now for a couple of years. Who do men say that I am? Who is the Son of Man? Because as I've told you before, the term Son of Man in Aramaic just means a man. It doesn't really mean anything specifically. So the question becomes, who do they say that I am? And they give the variety of answers. And we know, for example, Herod thought he was John the Baptist coming back from the dead. And he'd risen from out of his tomb to come back and haunt him. Some say that he's Elijah, that he's preparing for the coming of the Messiah. Some say Jeremiah, who prophesies the destruction of Jerusalem, and they say, or one of the other prophets. And after they've answered that question, our Lord then asks them, who do you say that I am? That's people. But who do you who have been with me now these many, many months, who do you say that I am? And that's when Simon answers back immediately, apparently. And he says, you are the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God. Now this is a profession of faith in our Lord's divinity. It's not just simply you're a prophet, because the term Son of God can mean just prophet. Someone who's close to God. So these terms have a great importance, but St. Peter winds up prophesying in the sense of professing his faith in the divinity of our Lord as truly Son of God. And that's why our Lord immediately says, you are blessed in his person, Simon, son of Jonah, Bar-Yonah. Simon, son of Jonah, flesh and blood, the Aramaic description of humanity, of human nature, flesh and blood, very earthly. St. John in his description, and the Word became flesh. This notion, he says, it's not just by living with me for the last couple years that you discern this. At no point does anyone looking at our Lord see some kind of a sign flashing saying divine. They see a man. So the profession of faith that Simon is giving here, our Lord is indicating as being foundational. It is not flesh and blood that has given this to you to understand, but my Father in heaven. And then he brings up this name, Rock. And you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. And so all of the scenery around them, the city of Caesarea, this huge boulder, this brand new city, wealth, power, that is part of the symbolism of what our Lord is telling these men, of the kingdom of God. That it is grounded upon faith, upon revelation, but it has the solidity as it comes from God, the solidity of anything greater than any stone. And then we have, of course, the personal failure of Peter. Because our Lord then begins to say, now we're going to go to Jerusalem, we're going to go south again, and I'm going to be betrayed, and I'm going to be handed over to the pagans, and I will be spit upon and scourged and crucified, and on the third day, rise from the dead. And for Simon, this doesn't fit in. Remember, this was glory. This is the magnificence of Caesarea. This is the strength of this hillside, this cliff, this rock. So how is it that the Messiah is now going to be humiliated publicly? This isn't going to happen. And Simon says this to our Lord. This is far be this from you, Lord. And this is when our Lord calls Simon Satan. Shatan is an adversary. Your thoughts are not the thoughts of God. You think like a man. I have just told you of the revelation given to you that is not of flesh and blood. And I continue to tell you what is God's plan, and you go, no, not that way. You are adversarial to me. You are Satan. Get behind me. You can imagine Simon's face just kind of drop. This moment of glory in the north, and as they're heading south, he's being rebuked. But he's being rebuked because he thinks too much like a man. You're not listening to what I'm telling you. You've just said that I am the Son of God. I'm telling you how this is going to work. And you go, no, that's different. We do this all the time individually in our lives. God reveals to us things, shows us paths, asks us to carry the cross. And we're like, no, this is what I prayed my novena for. It's supposed to be different. And our Lord is always guiding us. And so, of course, we have no response from Simon. He doesn't respond. Clearly rebuked, clearly pulled back in. But our Lord is giving us a very important lesson, which is why he doesn't want this to be politicized, but to be taught in a supernatural sense. Which is why at the end of this gospel, he tells the disciples, you're to tell no one that I am the Christ, that I am the Messiah. So let us turn this day for the intercession of Simon, St. Peter, that the wisdom that he learned over those years, and finally in this great beauty on the day of Pentecost, that he may obtain that grace for us individually, to learn, to see, to profess a faith which has a solidity, but at the same time is always in that strength, because of that strength, open to be taught about the next step. May his intercession be for this grace of wisdom and of light and of patience and of humility to be led down the path which isn't one that we always actually want to follow. So that we may see the glory of the kingdom, that we may participate in the unchangeability of that faith, and in that strength, that we may become ever more perfected as the children of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. you stand. That's a great building which is sanctified by the memories of Christ, of which we are, and as a memorial, also part of our baptism, we will also sprinkle the entire congregation with the sacred waters.
Amen.
you, Lord and God, you accept the offerings of our ancestors. Now accept these offerings that your children have brought to you. Honor their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them. And in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ in his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the repose of their vigil, and for the intentions of all the members of the parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Thank you.
peace and security in your true love and divine mercy be with us and among us all the days of our lives, that we may raise glory and thanks to you now and forever.
Amen.
O Lord, we bow before you and ask you to look upon us with mercy. Make us worthy to approach your holy altar with pure hearts and holy souls and bodies, that we may raise glory and thanks to you now and forever.
Amen.
The love of God, the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do Do so in memory of me until I come again.
We remember your death, O Lord. We profess your resurrection. We await your second coming. We implore your mercy and compassion. We ask for the forgiveness of sins. And may your mercy rest upon us.
O Lord, lover of all people,
remember
your plan of salvation. And we ask you to have mercy on your worshipers and to save your inheritance when you appear at the end of time, to reward all people justly according to their deeds. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you implores your Father, saying,
especially Mary, the Holy Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles,
St. Maron, St. Charbel. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers of the true faith who have endured sufferings for the sake of your church and your people. May we truly and faithfully follow in their footsteps. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful departed who have left us and have gone to their rest, hoping in you, awaiting that life-giving voice calling them to life. Accept the offerings we present to you on their behalf, and have mercy on them in your kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us, O God, to be wise, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility,
and asking for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity. One Holy Father,
one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, for He is one in heaven and on earth, to the end and glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by Your holy body, and that our souls purified by Your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord,
I sent him.
communion be for the forgiveness of sins and the glory of your holy name, that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you. Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation and make us temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.